Okay, I'll begin with some outlines from the book of Amos. Book of Amos. Not just Amos, this actually spreads through Amos and a few other books. Okay. And that's on the theme of the Day of the Lord. The Day of the Lord. In fact, it's a very popular, it's a major minor prophets theme, if I can say that. It's a major minor prophets theme because every 13 out of 16 writing prophets talk about the Day of the Lord. That's a lot of number. 13 out of 16 writing prophets, including the minor prophets. Only three prophets don't talk about it. Thank you. Only three prophets don't talk about it. So I'm going to give you a brief outline about the Day of the Lord, how we can actually use it for our times and our ministry. Just give me a moment. It's been a long day. The Day of the Lord. The Day of the Lord, a study from minor prophets. So, okay, now you're talking about teaching minor prophets, and some of the audience have no idea, some of them don't even know the name of the minor prophets, let's be frank. So I sing this song, some of you know this song. It's actually a Sunday school song called Grand Old Book. The Grand Old Book, the Grand Old Book, you'll find the words of comfort wherever you may look, in sorrow, in pain, his promises are plain. So keep on believing the Grand Old Book, it says. And then the chorus, and I'm just going to go the second part because that involves the second chorus, second stanza, which begins with Ecclesiastes. It says, Ecclesiastes, Song of Solomon, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Lamentations, Ezekiel, Daniel, Hosea, Joel, Amos, Obadiah, Jonah, Micah, Nahum, Habakkuk, Zephaniah, Haggai, Zechariah, Malachi. So that even that order, you know, some of us, some of the modern believers don't know. But you're trying to preach from that section of the Bible to a modern audience. And how do you begin? Okay, you say talk of the Day of the Lord. I would typically talk about some gripping days, you know. For example, in the Indian context, some unforgettable days. May 21st, 1991. Can you remember May 21st, 1991? Rajiv Gandhi's assassination. Yeah, May 21st, 1991. Unforgettable day, Rajiv Gandhi, India's former Prime Minister, became piece of flesh in a field in Tamil Nadu after a belt bomb went off, you know. So you can talk about some gripping days. Then we can actually talk about days from different fields, like you can also talk about April, if I'm not wrong, April 2nd, 2011. Is day when India won the World Cup. India won the World Cup beating Sri Lanka. India became the first team to win the World Cup at home when Dhoni promoted himself in the order and played a heroic 90 plus innings to take India to victory. So you can just, whatever may be the audience, talk about a little bit about that that important day. So get people interested in that day. And then you start off by saying, okay, and then if you are talking to a little international audience, no bigger day than September 11th.
World Trade Center,
yes. World Trade Center. Then the American people are now looking forward to the third debate, which is on October 19th, the showdown between Hillary and Donald Trump, and then the president election next month. So you can talk of any number of days. So get the audience interested on the day. And then, for example, you're talking to young people, you say, so young people, you're dreaming about your first, your day of marriage and your first night. You know, you can make it as humorous or as light as possible. Students, you're dreaming about the day when the exam will get over. Okay, the last day of exam, so you can just throw your pens out or have a celebration. So focus on that day. Yeah, please come. Focus on that day and... then start off with, so then we can look at what the minor prophets, what the prophets say about the Day of the Lord. And let's, and because this message has got loaded with a lot of images of judgment, I sort of qualified by saying that God loves you. And never doubt for a moment that God, I'm not here to announce that God hates you or God is about to send you to hell. That's not my point. God loves us, and because He loves us, He wants us. Okay, warning, if you really love someone, you'll also want that person. If a person is walking, if a blind man is walking on the top of a mountain and that mountain is having a steep cliff, and if he's walking towards that edge of the cliff, you're going to scream, you're going to shout, you're going to warn him, because if he keeps going that way, he's going to come crashing down. So you have to connect love with judgment, because a truly loving preacher, a truly loving God will always warn his people. He will not hide these warnings. So this is basically a message of warning. And so with those introductory remarks, God is saying God is love. Then you come to talk about the day of the Lord. This is a good full commitment message, calling people for full commitment, calling people for total commitment, or even it can be even a gospel message. First, okay, most of these points are from Book of Amos. The day of the Lord is sure. It is sure. Amos chapter, it's coming from the Book of Amos. Amos 5, 18 and 19. Amos 5, 18 and 19. Would you want to read it? Okay, it's a very powerful passage. Amos 5, 18 and 19. It's talking about a man running from a lion. And he runs away from the lion. He turns back, no lion. Then a bear chases him, and then he turns back, and the bear is not there. So he's escaped from the lion, escaped from the bear, and finally, when he goes into a house, and there's a crack in the wall of the house, and a snake comes and bites him. It's a beautiful parable. In fact, the thing that comes to my mind is Amos. Who's writing these words? Who's writing his words? Amos. What is his profession?
Shepherd.
Okay, shepherd one season and agriculture man one season. But okay, we know him as a shepherd. So where do you find that? You find that in chapter Amos chapter 7, 14 and 15. Okay, now he's that's his background. So what do you think a shepherd would have done? What you think is a shepherd? Is he well like a professor in a college or a school teacher to school children? So a school teacher to school children, professor in a college is always giving speeches, or a president of a country giving speeches, or a CEO of a company is giving pep talks. But what do you think of the best speech a shepherd gave was? Must have said drrr, drrr, drrr all day long. I mean, absolutely no training in speech making, oratory, or sentence making, or nothing. But this man comes up with an amazing story. A lion chasing a man chased by a lion, he escapes the lion. A man chased by a bear, he escapes the bear, and finally a snake catches up with him. So why is he saying? Why is he saying that? Look at 5:18. Amos 5:18.
Woe to you who long for the day of the Lord.
Who long for the day of the Lord.
Why do you long for the day of the Lord?
Why do you long for the day of the Lord?
That day will be darkness, not
that
light.
That day will be darkness and not light. Okay.
Only to meet a bear.
Uh-huh.
And so he entered his house and rested his hand on the wall,
mm-hmm.
only to have a snake bite him.
Okay.
Will not the day of the Lord be darkness, not light?
Yes.
Pitch dark without a ray of brightness.
Okay. Now the people of Israel longed for the day of the Lord, as if thinking the day of the Lord, God is going to give them a big reward and give them a big congratulations and then take them straight to paradise. But the day of the Lord is going to be a sad day. He's coming, but it's going to be sure. It's going to be sure. That's the first thing he says. They think they can run away from the day of judgment, but the day of judgment will catch up with them. So again, so we can tell modern believers, whether they believe in Jesus or not, whether they like Jesus or not, whether they accept his uniqueness or not, the fact remains, one day he's going to come back and he's going to judge them, whether they acknowledge it or not. Okay, so it's sure, whether you believe it or not, whether you like it or not, it is sure. And in fact, even a much better reference then this would be Amos 9, 2 to 4. Amos 9, 2 to 4. Come, come. Amos 9, 2 to 4. It's, I think I've written it from the NLT. It says, they dig down to the place of the dead in Amos 9, 2 to 4.
I saw the Lord standing upon the altar.
Okay.
And he said, smite the lintel of the door, that the posts may shake, and cut them in the head.
Okay.
All of them. And I will give it to
them. Amos, Amos.
Though they dig down to the depths of the grave.
Amos 9. Amos 9, 2 to 4. Yeah.
Though they dig down to the depths of the grave.
Okay.
From there my hand will take them.
Mm-hmm.
Though they climb up to the heavens.
From
there I will bring them down.
In fact, this is an even better reference for, even if they climb up to the heaven, God says, I'm going to bring them down. Okay. And though they,
though they hide themselves on the top of Carmel.
Okay. About Carmel, if you do some study Bible reading or some background reading, it is the last point of land, last point you can still be in land and still be in Israel, because Carmel is jutting into the sea. So under that mountain, Mount Carmel, there's actually sea, because it's moving over the sea, and you have water below. The cliff is built that way. It's moving into the sea, but below there is sea, and it's in this shape, like a sea. It is like a sea, it is beside the sea, S-E-A. And so which means the structure of the mountain is, you can still, that's the last point of Israel you can be in when you're in the land. Beyond that you can't go. If you go, you'll fall into the sea. So that's what God is actually saying here.
Though they hide themselves
on the top of Carmel, I will hunt them down and seize them. Okay. That's what Donald Trump promises to do to the ISIS. I'll hunt them down, you know, hunt them down. I'll smoke them out. I'll completely erase them wherever they are. Okay, that's one of his big promises. Okay, and then please go on.
Though they hide from me at the bottom of the sea.
Okay, bottom of the sea. So, heavens.
There I command the serpent to bite them.
Okay, bottom of the sea. Some of you may watch some Nat Geo shows where you have these deadly snakes and octopuses and all that, deadly animals that stay right at the bottom of the ocean. So bottom of the ocean, top of heaven, last point this way. Wherever you go, you can't escape. So which means the day of judgment cannot be escaped. And if you come to the New Testament, now we'll come to that. I believe it's in the book of Galatians Galatians 6, 7. Okay, Galatians 6, 7, it says, scripture says, Galatians 6, 7. Do not be misled. Yes.
God cannot be mocked.
God cannot be mocked.
A man reaps what he sows.
A man will reap what he sows. Okay. There's a certainty. It's not a man may reap.
A man reaps.
There is a certainty. There is a day of judgment coming. So that's the first teaching that we can actually bring. It's the certainty of judgment. Certainty of second coming, certainty of judgment. A man reaps what a person plants, he will harvest. I think that's one verse, that's New Living Translation. What a person plants, he will harvest. In fact, after September 11, Colin Powell, one of the military leaders of the US, said, you don't attack America like this and get away with it. That means at that time George Bush Jr. was in power. So he went after them, you know. He went after them like, you know, but one of the complaints that they have about Barack Obama is he's giving millions of dollars to Iranians to release some Americans. He says, that's not the way of America, Donald Trump says. You go and bomb them, you go and bulldoze them. You don't give them millions of dollars and request them, can you please send back our citizens? That's not the way America does. America always has really used force. So George Bush said, you don't attack America like this and get away with it. And as long as he was in power, I mean, that there was no major terrorist attack in the US, because they really took a serious stance. So we could use as many illustrations as possible to underline the fact that day of reckoning is coming. Okay, and the next thing about the day of the Lord, it will be shocking. It will be It is sure, it is shocking. Now, let's read Amos 9:10, and we already read Amos 5:18. Amos 5:18 ideally would come here, but that was a good introduction as well. Amos 9:10. So Amos is ministering primarily to the northern kingdom of Israel. Last week we studied that. Okay, northern kingdom of Israel, the 10 tribes, first 10 tribes in the north. Okay, the house of Joseph, that's called. Another name for northern kingdom is house of Joseph. Okay, can we read Amos 9:10?
All the sinners among my people will die by the sword.
Okay.
All those who say disaster will not overtake.
Oh, yes. Them. Okay, what did they say? Disaster will not
overtake.
Which means, down through history, there are people who think disaster will not overtake us, even during the period of Amos. So, do you remember there was a priest, Amos chapter 7, this story comes up, a priest called Amaziah. He tells Amos to go back to his hometown, because Amos is not from, he's from Tekoa. Amos is from where? Tekoa. And he says, go back to Tekoa, don't stay in Bethel, because we don't want to hear your prophecies, because he's prophesying judgment. So the king doesn't want to hear your prophecy, and then the priest is in, no, priest and the king are in the same frequency. So Amaziah, that man's name is Amaziah, you read about him in 7:12, you want to read it?
Then Amaziah said to Amos,
okay.
Get out, you seer.
Get out, you seer. That means, because he is pronouncing judgment, he says, get out, don't even stay here. We don't have any place for prophets like you in our land. Okay?
Go back to the land of Judah.
Go back to the land of Judah, because he's from Judah. He's from just outside of Jerusalem, a place called Tekoa. Okay?
Earn your bread there and do your prophesying there.
Earn your bread there, which means, I know I'm digressing. He is in the ministry to eat bread. So he thinks all the others are also like that. So you go there and you preach and earn your bread. Because if you keep preaching like this, nobody will give us any offering for us to eat bread. So you go back to your place and preach your messages there. You earn your bread there. Let us allow us to preach these nice sounding messages so that we can earn our bread here. Okay, yes. That's it?
No,
don't prophesy anymore at Bethel. Okay,
because this is the king's sanctuary and the temple of the kingdom.
Because this is the king's sanctuary and the temple of the kingdom. So Amos 9:10 is talking about prophets. People think they are secure, they have no problem. Not just that, all through this book, look at Amos 6:1 and 8. Amos 6:1 and 8. The security of the people. Amos 6, they feel so secure, and the day of the Lord will come as shock. Amos 6:1.
Woe to you who are complacent in Zion.
Who are what is the meaning of complacency?
Lazy,
yeah.
Casual,
okay, nothing is gonna, nothing wrong, okay, I don't have to practice anymore, I don't have to work hard anymore, I don't have to pray anymore, no, I don't have to do my fitness drills anymore, and from a sportsman's point, okay, if you're a teacher, I don't have to go through my notes anymore. I mean, so it's complacency as grip. Woe to those who are complacent in which place?
Complacent in Zion.
Zion, okay.
And to you who feel secure on Mount Samaria.
Mount Samaria, okay, yes. Mount Samaria is northern kingdom, yes.
You notable men of the foremost nation.
Okay.
To whom the people of Israel come.
Yes, and verse 8.
The sovereign Lord has sworn by himself, the Lord God Almighty declares.
Okay.
I abhor the pride of Jacob
and detest his fortresses. The pride of Jacob, pride thinking nothing wrong is going to happen. So when the day of the judgment comes, okay, in fact, as I said last week, the day of judgment means the day when the Assyrians will come and attack them in the year 722 BC. That was what primarily it means. So, but nobody believed the end of the northern kingdom was coming. So when it actually came, it's surprising, and the New Testament translation is, nobody will believe Jesus is actually going to come back. Okay. And nobody believes there's going to be a day of judgment. So it's going to be a big shock. Not only sure, but it's going to be a big shock. It's going to be a big shock. All right, and then thirdly, in fact, here you could have subpoints under this, wherein, okay, now if, why are people, okay, if people are so complacent, that means they have that trust in something. So people in Amos' time had the trust in, they had the trust in complacent because of prosperity. I already talked about it. So they had what? Amos 3:15. They had summer houses and winter houses. So people were so rich, they had summer houses and winter houses. So they had every reason to be complacent. And then not only that, they had okay, they thought they were chosen. Complacent because they were chosen by God. So, and what does he say in Amos 3:2, they were chosen by God, they were the chosen country. Amos 3:2,
you only have I chosen of all the families of the earth.
Okay, so yes. You only have I chosen from all the families of the earth,
therefore I will punish you for all your
okay
sins.
This is the second sentence is very different. Amos uses, you are complacent because you think you're chosen, but being chosen means you have extra responsibility, because God did not choose some other countries. God chose you to be the, you know, to be the light unto the Gentiles. God sent the light to you first so that you can reflect that light. So you have a greater responsibility. And if you still are not going to live up to the responsibility and still live in sin, you know, the punishment is going to be greater for you. So that's why it's going to be shocking. And not just that, so we can actually talk about the wrong things that people have in our, when you're bringing that message to present day believers. So why will the day of judgment be a shock to modern day believers? For example, if they are believing, they're thinking that, okay, I have religion. Okay, I come to church, I pay my tithe, okay, I sing in the choir, I get involved in the ministry. So are these things good? Absolutely. But will these things save? Absolutely not. So what are they putting their trust in for their salvation? Okay. Yeah, good deeds. Okay, maybe they have an elaborate work to elevating the poor from the poverty. Maybe they are rescuing, people in sexual slavery from outside and bringing them out. In fact, some of the New Testament questions you can quote is from Matthew 23. Matthew 23, you can pick up the exact verse where it says, these people, these Pharisees, they travel land and sea to make a convert, which means they were missionaries. They were in the ministry. They travel overseas, land over land and overseas to win a convert, but they would make them twice the sons of hell as they were. Some of you are blinking. You've not read that verse? Amos and Matthew 23. So they used to go for foreign trips and international programs and win converts. And the converts are twice the sons of hell as they are, which means they are doing the ministry, but they're not going to go to heaven. They're going to go to hell. That's what Jesus taught in Matthew 23. So wrong confidence doing ministry. You can talk about anything. Giving. In fact, we will come to that verse in the book of Zephaniah. Zephaniah 1:18, I guess. Zephaniah 1:18, putting the trust on money. I think money given to as offering. Okay, offerings are good, and we all need offerings to run our ministry, so I'm not undermining that. But offering, just because somebody gave you an offering, that doesn't mean that person will go to heaven automatically. Zephaniah 1:18, I think, if I'm not wrong, neither the silver nor the gold will be able to save them on the day of God's wrath. Again, the day of the Lord concept in the book of Zephaniah. Neither the silver nor the... Zephaniah is talking to the people. To the southern kingdom, people in the southern kingdom, towards the end of the southern kingdom, all the offerings they bring, and in southern kingdom they had Jerusalem temple, okay, so all the offerings you bring in the Jerusalem temple, Okay, if it, your life has not changed, it's not going to save you from the day of God's wrath. So you can elaborately talk about the wrong things that people trust in. So it's to be sure it is shocking. Okay, I'm going to quickly move then. The thirdly, it will be, what do you think? Give me an S. Give me an S for God. Give me an S about the day of the Lord. It will be sudden.
Sudden.
MO 6-7 talks about suddenly all your revelry will come to an end. Suddenly all your revelry will come to an end. The northern kingdom of Israel have no, I mean, they have no clue the Assyrians are going to come and completely wipe them out. Suddenly, it's all going to happen suddenly. Now, can you think of any other kingdom the end came so suddenly and so dramatically? In fact, sometime back, Sister Stubbs preached about that. Not recent, I mean, about maybe a month or two back, at least 2 months back. From the book of Daniel. Remember the king?
Belshazzar.
Okay, Belshazzar. Daniel.
Daniel?
Yeah, Daniel. Book of Daniel, yes.
Isn't Belshazzar the name of Daniel?
Okay, in fact, I don't rule out the possibility of me getting confused. Daniel, it's the king's name, fortunately. 5:30. That very night, that very night, Belshazzar, king of the Babylonians, was slain, and Darius the Medes, that very night, which means the attack was so sudden. Then, do you remember another very night in Luke chapter 12? To the rich fool, Jesus said, tonight you're... So, are you, I mean, the thing is, you might as well preach a message from the rich fool. You might as well, you know, that's a familiar passage for our church people. But if you begin it from the minor prophets, it also, what are you doing? You're actually trying to get them interested in an unfamiliar portion of the scripture. So that they will go back and read it. My interest in minor prophets began because for some reason the senior faculty available in SABC during the time when I went to SABC 1998 to 2001, he was doing his PhD in the US, and then they had a couple of teachers, and they were all new to the job, so they did their best, but the students wanted to know more. So they said, okay Duke, why don't you study and teach us? So I went to all these wonderful dictionaries that we have in our library, and I read, and I also reflected, and I also had my own study Bibles, which my dad had gifted me over the years, and I went and read those, and I found this is some one section of the Bible I am not doing justice at all by not, I'm skipping it wholesale, I'm not reading it at all, I have to spend time. And good thing is it's all also very short books, it's not really long, I can read most of the books in one sitting, and they have a message for our times. They're not contradicting the New Testament, they are complementing the New Testament. And they're doing it so captivatingly, like lion, bear, snake, you know, what a wonderful story that is. So that's the third thing about the day of the Lord. Sure, shocking, and it will be sudden. So that Jesus coming, so can we, what is the New Testament teaching? The New Testament teaches, we all know the scriptures, where, you know, you can take time to find that. The New Testament teaches that nobody can exactly pinpoint when Jesus is going to come. Nobody knows. Only the Father in heaven knows. So we can talk about all the signs of the times and we can line them up. But even then we can't pinpoint and say, okay, this particular day or this particular night, second he's going to come. He's not, we have no idea. It could take another 100 years, or it could be tomorrow, it could be tonight, it could be another 1,000 years. We have no clue. But we know we are living in the last days. Living in the last seconds of the last hour of the last days, biblically speaking. But we don't know when those, we still don't know which will be the last second. we need to be ready. So it can be sudden, and then so parable which talks about sudden entry, the ten virgins. Yes. So you have a choice whether to keep your feed your believers with ten virgin story all your life, rest of your life, or take them to passages like Minor Prophets and launch your study from there, and then you can launch a rocket, and that rocket can eventually land in ten virgins. But you don't have to start with ten virgins. So your congregation gets to appreciate the fact that, oh my God, this book, you know, the all of Scripture is actually written to edify, edify us, and edify us as believers. Okay. Now, so it will be sudden. It will be then fourth. Okay, some of these words more or less mean the same thing, but you know, I mean, on a lighter note, don't you think that's the job of preachers? They say the same thing, we're using different words, right? Preaching is constantly reminding people what they are constantly forgetting, using different words. But if you keep on repeating like a broken record, have you seen broken records? Then people will throw stones at you, or people will sleep on you. I mean, listen, sleep when you're preaching. But if you can say the same thing with the, I mean, I may not agree with Joel Osteen's theology much, but I love the way he can say the same thing using different vocabulary and keep the crowd spellbound, you know. Amazing. I'm a master at that. There are some preachers who are very good at it, you know. They can say the same thing, same biblical truth, but they use different words, and it's so awesome. It's so charismatic. It's so lovely. So again, these points, sometimes you might think it all means the same. Sure, and what is it? Shocking, sudden, and then swift. So swift is talking about, the day of the Lord is going to be sooner than we think. Sooner than we. Sooner than we think. Look at Amos 5:9. Amos 5:9. Can you read that, please?
He flashes destruction on the stronghold and brings the fortified city to ruin.
He brings the fortified city to ruin. Okay, he's talking about Assyrian army surrounding northern. One day it's going to surround northern kingdom, and they're going to. It's fortified. Samaria is fortified. It's going to come to an end. Okay, and verse 5:9 does it say with blinding speed and power he destroys the strong? 5:9. Yeah, flashes. The word flashes, I think in the NLT goes like with blinding speed, flash. It's so fast. And the Assyrian army, if you read some background, they are so fast. They are cold, clinical. Nahum chapter 2 verse 2, again from the Minor Prophets. Nahum 2:12 talks about the Assyrian army, how clinical they are. Nahum 2:12. They are described as a mighty lion. They are like a mighty lion. They are fast. They are fast. Now, how will we apply it in our life? Life is, okay, I said second coming can happen suddenly, but how will you bring it, make it relevant for the life of today's believers? Fast. The day of the Lord is fast. So how is it relevant? Okay, I said we can't zero in a day. So how else can it be fast? We can't say, okay, Jesus is coming back tomorrow morning at 8 o'clock, so get ready. So we can't say that. But in another sense, it's very fast. It will be swift. Why? Because we can die any moment. So when we die, we are literally, the day of the Lord is preponed for us, in a sense, because it doesn't matter what happens. I mean, after we die, we basically, what we look forward to is just judgment. After judgment, heaven or hell. So the day of the Lord is sort of preponed for us if we die. And we all can die any moment. And the New Testament calls our life as fleeting shadow. James 4:14. And the Old Testament, there are many images, and this is one image. Fading flower, Job 14:2. A flower which opens in the morning and dies in the evening. A shadow which is there in the morning and not there in the evening. It can go so suddenly. We have no clue when our end can come. No. Not just scriptures, but also characters like Absalom. Absalom, Ahab. I mean, you can line up all these characters. Suddenly they die. Suddenly they die. Then Luke 12:20, you fool, tonight your life will be taken. Tonight your life will be taken. You fool. So which means, why was he a fool? He had plans for 60, 70 years of his life, but no preparation for millions of years in eternity. Remember the Sunday when Pastor Walson brought one big rope in the in his message? Eternity, the size of it, our life here is the size of this much, but eternity is, the rope is so long, we can't even, the whole stage could not contain that rope, which means eternity is so long. But this man was a fool. Why was he a fool? He was thinking only about the 60, 70 years of life on here and now, but not about eternity. So it will be swift. And then, day of the Lord, which five is it? Five or six? A day of, another S, give me another S. Give me another S. What will happen the day of the Lord? A day of silence. Okay, for this you need to go to the book of Zephaniah. Zephaniah 1:7. Another minor prophet book, Zephaniah again. Zephaniah is prophesying to the southern kingdom, end of the southern kingdom, prophesying to Judah, Judah coming to Zephaniah 1:7.
Be silent before the sovereign Lord.
Be silent before the sovereign Lord.
For the day of the Lord is near.
For the day of the Lord is near.
The Lord has prepared a sacrifice.
Okay, yes. And then if you read verses 2 to 7, before that, why they have to be silent? Look at verse 2. Zephaniah 1:7 says, you basically shut up. You, before God, you have to only shut up. You can't open your mouth. Just have to shut your mouth and stand. Okay, why? Look at verse 2 to 7.
I will sweep away everything from the face of the earth, declares the Lord. I will sweep away both men and animals.
Yes.
I will sweep away the birds of the air and the fish of the sea. The wicked will have only heaps of rubble.
Okay.
When I cut off man from the face of the earth, declares the Lord. I will stretch out my hand against Judah and against all who live in Jerusalem.
Yes.
I will cut off from this place every remnant of Baal.
Okay. Every remnant of Baal. There you have. Why have they have to be silent? Because they have been involved in Baal worship, which is again connected to sexual prostitution. Okay, when they had the opportunity, they did not repent from Baal. They still stuck on to that sin. So when the day of the Lord comes, they have to, because they have no excuse. Why silent? No excuse. And does the New Testament also say the same thing? In fact, Paul says it so beautifully, I believe in the book of Romans, chapter 3, where he says, the whole world will be silenced and held accountable on the day of judgment.
19.
Romans 3:19.
Now we know that whatever the law says, says to those who are under the law, so okay, that every mouth may be silenced.
Every mouth may be silenced.
And Romans. The whole world held accountable to God.
Romans 3:19. Excellent. Yeah, thank you. Every mouth will be silenced and the whole world held accountable. It's talking about the day of the Lord, day of judgment. Every mouth will be silenced. There's no excuse. It's not like, I mean, what are some of the excuses you think believers will give on the day of judgment? Or, I mean, people of God will give on the day of judgment. I try to think about these things, especially when I'm speaking to young people. So one excuse, anybody wants to talk about this? What do you think can be an excuse? You can try. I'm sorry? Nobody shared the good news, okay. Okay.
The focus can be on worldly things.
Okay. Now, these are all, about the fate of the unevangelized, we have discussed. I mean, we had a series of study and we concluded they have no excuse. So I'm not going to get into that. One excuse could be like, how can I, as a human, I am 100% human, but Jesus is 100% human, but 100% God. So how can a 100% human follow Jesus, who is 100% human plus 100% God? So it's not possible. So I think I need to have some. So you think that argument can stand? That argument can't stand for two reasons. One, he gave you the power of the Holy Spirit to enable you to walk holy, but you're not used that power. You're not cooperated with the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is available, but you need to cooperate. It's like somebody looked at the Niagara Falls and said, there is the greatest unused source of power in the whole world. And then the next person next to him, a believer, said, the greatest unused source of power in the world is not the Niagara Falls, it's actually the power of the Holy Spirit. So we have, and then Apostle Paul. So that's why I'm repeatedly finding myself preaching about Apostle Paul in many of my the youth meetings I'm addressing, because here is one man, not five times, I can take you through all those references. Five times he said, follow me, and various words, not the same words. Apostle Paul was a master at repeating the same thing using different vocabulary. No, he was very good at that. So he said, follow me as I follow Christ. So was Paul 100% human? Was he 100% God? Absolutely not. But he could follow Jesus, is it in an exemplary manner. So there are examples in the Bible of people who are, I mean, was he sinless? Absolutely not. In fact, in Acts 23, I guess, he calls the Pharisees, you whitewashed tomb. Can you imagine him call, you think that is nice to call somebody whitewashed tomb? Maybe Paul would have thought, I'm imitating Jesus, because Jesus called the Pharisees, you whitewash tombs. Some of you are blinking, you don't, do you know that passage? Yeah. Acts 23,
yes.
You whitewashed. But then Paul realized he's a leader, he should not have talked about it. And if you read it in the Message version, he says, I'm sorry. He apologizes. He's not perfect. Paul is not perfect. He had a problem with temper a little bit. Okay, but he says, I'm sorry. And then but at the same time, Paul is not living in willful sin. He's always growing from glory to glory. And he is able to tell his people, follow me as I follow Christ. So the whole, I don't believe we will have any excuse on the day of judgment. And even if we think of giving some excuse, there'll be something which will shut our mouth up. We'll be silenced. We'll be silenced. So it'll be a day of silence. And then finally, a day that is, wanna guess? Three letter word. Sad, yeah. Okay, that's going to be very sad. Why sad? It's actually 7. My numbering has got messed up. Why? Look at Amos 8:10. On the day of the Lord, what's going to happen? Amos 8:10. On that, yeah, you can read it if you have it.
I will turn your religious
feasts
into
mourning. I will turn your religious feasts into mourning.
And all your singing into weeping.
All your singing into weeping. I mean, he's talking about how all the religious festivities of, you know, it's going to completely turn into feasts of mourning. Why? The Assyrians will come and uproot them. And even if we take what he said was for the southern kingdom, all the temple activity will be stopped by the Babylonians. All the you remember the chorus which we read about in the Psalms, by the rivers of Babylon where we sat down. So we hung a harp. Why? The harp or the guitar or the violin or the bongos or whatever it is, that is a symbol of what? Joy and worship and jubilation. But because their enemy has attacked them, the Babylonians attacked them, they are not able to be happy and joyous. So that's the original meaning. But for the modern believer, why will it be sad the day of the Lord? because it's going to be a life of, what did Jesus say? How did he describe hell? Okay, that's what is going to happen after the day of the Lord. It's going to be a place of weeping and
gnashing of teeth.
So many times in Matthew's Gospel. Repeatedly in Matthew's Gospel. Weeping and gnashing of teeth. Why? It's going to be a place of, as David Pawson says, it's going to be a place of sadness and frustration. Place of where you'll be sad and you'll be frustrated. Why will you be sad? Because you have missed a lot of chances which you could have used. And if you had used those chances, you would not have come to this place. That's why you'll be sad. Frustrated, why? There's no exit. Why frustration? Why biting of teeth? No exit from this place. This is going to be forever and forever and ever. Doesn't matter what people like John Stott and other great Bible scholars say. There is scriptural evidence. It's going to be a place forever, ever, and ever. You know, the book of Revelation is very, very clear. Okay? Weeping and gnashing of teeth. In fact, if you want to give a little more historical context, Amos 5:27, it says they will be sent to a foreign country. Why will they be sad? They'll be sent to a foreign country. So, I mean, if you want to send your son or daughter who grew up in your home, and you're going to threaten them, I'll send you to a hostel. See the reaction. See the reaction. They're not happy. They're not jumping. No, they don't want to. Because going out of your home, you know, going to a foreign country, you know, that is one reason why they're sad. And then Amos 7:9, the king dies. The king dies, the death of a king. Now, if you have a good king, and if you are hero worshipping that king, and if he dies, there's a lot of sadness. When a leader goes, there's a lot of sadness. Okay, and then what happened? Okay, this is really classic. Okay, Amos 9:8. What happened to Egypt is now happening to Israel. So what happened to Egypt? Plagues came on Egypt. And the same plagues are now coming on Israel. So it's going to be sad. What happened to your worst enemy? What happened to the pagans are now happening to you? So this is one reason why they were sad. But for the modern believer, you know, Day of Judgment can be a place, a day of sadness. Why? Because, you know, if you reject Christ, you're going to go to eternal hell. And hell is a really sad, sad, sad place. And then finally, how will be the day of the Lord? How will be the day of the Lord? A day to smile, yes. Okay, now this is a passage which a lot of some of my Hippocrates friends have referred to, but I believe this is really talking about the eschatological end age. Okay, let's look at Zephaniah chapter 3. Zephaniah 3:17.
The Lord your God is with you.
Okay.
He is mighty to save.
The Lord your God is with you.
He is mighty to save.
He is mighty to save.
He will take great delight in you.
He will take great delight in you.
He will quiet you with his love.
He will quiet you with his love.
He will rejoice over you with singing.
He will rejoice over you with singing. Okay. Now, this is the life of a believer who is in Christ. And he stays that way, you know, not, you know, he is not a backslider, he is not a stubborn believer, stubborn and sin believer. But he, now the verse is very, very clear. It says he is constantly in God's presence. Because the Lord is with you, and he is mighty to save. Okay, he's saved but not yet saved. He's already but not yet saved. He's already saved but not yet saved. Already but not yet. We know that. Okay, and he will take great delight in you. Now, of course, this scripture can be fully understood only when you come to the New Testament, where we read Romans 8:1. What does it say? There is no condemnation for those who are
in Christ Jesus.
Okay. Does it say those who once were in Christ Jesus? Once upon a time in Christ Jesus? Those who are. It's talking about a present reality. Present, daily, continuous reality. So when you're in Christ Jesus, you know, what does God do? He takes great delight in you. Okay, and that means you have a reason to smile. And he will quiet you with his love. You're in his love. And there is no question of you fearing hell punishment. Because you are in Christ. So you're not thinking, okay, if you're on a flight and the flight is wobbling and they are running into bad weather, and you're thinking you might go down the sea, down and the end might be near. You have the assurance. In fact, Steve Hill, who is no longer with us and is going to be with Jesus, talks about a situation wherein he was on a flight and the flight was wobbling. And there are people who are so panicking. And this Assembly of God evangelist, also a great, he mentored Michael Brown, who wrote the book Hyper Grace. And he also was intern mentored by Leonard Ravenhill, another great revival writer. Leonard Ravenhill, Steve Hill, Michael Brown, all of them are birds of the same feather. Okay, all of them, so they are Assemblies of God, they are Arminian, they are not Calvinistic, they are not Hypergrace. So, but you know, he said, he's not thinking, just because he believes you can lose salvation, it's not like he's thinking, in this flight, if I die, I have to wait like the Muslim on the Day of Judgment, then I will know. God will weigh my good deeds and bad deeds, and then I will know whether I will go to heaven or hell. We're not saying that. We have the assurance of salvation because, you know what, you are in Christ. You're abiding in Christ. And you know on the Day of Judgment you will smile. You have no doubt. You are absolutely no doubt. Because you're abiding in Christ. You have rejected sin. All conscious sin you rejected. You're not living in the habit of sin. Again, not because of your own effort, because of the enablement of the Holy Spirit with your active cooperation. So that day of the Lord will be